Beste mensen, reisgenoten op de weg naar een klimaatbestendige toekomst. Goed dat jullie vandaag deelnemen aan dit webinar. Vandaag is een Nederlandse mijlpaal op weg naar de Climate Adaptation Summit van 25 januari 2021. Op die dag zullen leiders van over de hele wereld een gezamenlijke Adaptation Action Agenda presenteren. Een agenda met concrete acties die de wereld voorbereidt op de gevolgen van klimaatverandering. Om weerbaarder te zijn tegen het jaar 2030. Want we hebben geen tijd te verliezen. Elke minuut verdwijnt er ongeveer 1 miljoen ton ijs in Groenland en Antarctica. Meer dan 3 miljoen ton in de tijd dat jullie naar dit filmpje kijken. De coronacrisis laat daarnaast zien hoe kwetsbaar we zijn. Hoe moeilijk het is om snel en effectief te reageren als we door een pandemie worden overvallen. Klimaatverandering overvalt ons niet. We weten heel goed wat er aan de hand is. We zien de effecten om ons heen. Droogte, overstromingen, vaker storm, opwarming van de aarde en zeespiegelstijging. We zitten nu in de penarie, dus we moeten ook nu wat doen. Daarom delen we onze kennis en ervaring en bundelen we onze krachten wereldwijd. Want klimaatverandering speelt overal en vraagt overal om maatregelen. Van delta's tot droge hoogvlaktes. We hebben in Nederland een eeuwenoude mondiale reputatie op het gebied van waterbeheer en nu ook van klimaatadaptatie. Vandaag staan 9 Nederlandse innovaties centraal. 9 interactieve webinars over de Nederlandse aanpak, waar de rest van de wereld hopelijk wat aan kan hebben. Klimaatverandering beïnvloedt ons dagelijks leven. Het is een mondiaal probleem dat vraagt om een mondiale gezamenlijke aanpak. In januari 2021 organiseren we daarom de Internationale Climate Adaptation Summit. En vandaag bespreken we daarvoor een aantal Nederlandse showcases. Ik wens jullie een mooie en inspirerende dag.
Thank you very much. Welcome to Pachacucha at the Climate Adaptation Festival. My name is Jeroen Beekmans. I'm working for Pop-Up City. And we are hosting this program. We have some great presenters lined up for you who will be talking about great ideas and work in the fields of climate adaptation. But before we proceed, we're going to watch another video message, this time from the alderman of the city of Amsterdam, Laurens Evens.
Welkom. Welkom bij dit festival en leuk dat jij je hebt aangemeld. De mens is een onderdeel van de natuur, maar helaas verpesten we die natuur ook heel snel. Daarom moeten we klimaatverandering tegengaan en moeten we strijden voor een klimaatbestendige samenleving. Dat doen we als stad bijvoorbeeld door allemaal innovatieve projecten te starten. Zoals de blauwgroene daken of de verkoelende sportvelden. Maar we moeten vooral allemaal zelf beseffen dat we onderdeel zijn van die natuur. En dat betekent geen tegels en dergelijke, maar planten en bomen. Die moeten we zien in onze eigen omgeving. Die bijdrage kunnen we allemaal leveren. Maar ik ben vooral heel blij dat jij jouw bijdrage wil leveren. Jouw bijdrage op dit festival. Veel plezier.
Thank you. Laurens Evens, I think, is saying it nicely. It's about your participation in climate adaptation. And in this program, this Pachacucha program, that is taking place in the next hour, we're going to listen to a lot of great, tangible, concrete, creative, inspiring ideas from fashion designers, from architects, from urban designers, from beer brewers, who are all working on the same field, the same theme, climate adaptation, how to deal with climate change. Before we are going to listen to our first presenters, I would like to explain a bit more about us and about the Pachacucha format. We are Pop-Up City, as I told you, an office for spatial transformation based in Amsterdam. And this time we are proudly hosted by the Road to Climate Adaptation Summit 2021. A short introduction about what Pachacucha is. Maybe some of you have seen Pachacucha before, maybe some of you haven't seen Pachacucha. Pachacucha is a presentation format that originates from Tokyo. It was founded in 2003 by an architecture firm called Klein Dytem Architecture. they are having their own nightclub in Roppongi, the district Roppongi in Tokyo, and they started organizing creative presentation events for especially young talented creatives in Tokyo to share their work and ideas, to mingle, to build a network, and to get inspired in general. There is one thing that's special about this event, and this is also the thing that we're going to work with in this coming hour. Every presenter on the stage today, of our 8 presenters, is allowed 20 images on the screen, and every image will be on the screen for only 20 seconds. This gives each presenter 400 seconds of fame, or 6 minutes and 40 seconds before the next presenter is up. Pecha Kucha originates from Tokyo, but started expanding to other cities in the world. It's taking place in over 1,200 cities around the globe at the moment. And we are, as Pop-Up City, the local Amsterdam organization of Pecha Kucha. We're organizing these events 4 to 6 times a year in different venues and locations across the city. And today we are proud to be here at the Climate Adaptation Festival with a themed program of people who are all working in this field of climate adaptation. If you want to see more about our events, or if you want to see more about our presenters, if you want to get in touch with them, I advise you to come and visit pechakucha.amsterdam. You'll find an extensive archive of creative talent in the Netherlands, people who have presented at our previous events, and you can click through to their websites to find out more about these people. If you want to follow us on social media, we are on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, you name it. So just type in Pecha Kucha Amsterdam and you will find us. And make sure to follow us to keep track of what we are doing. That's in a nutshell what Pecha Kucha is. Today we have a great lineup of 8 presenters. It's very fast-paced, so we're going to listen to a lot of ideas, a great diversity of ideas, work, projects of these highly interesting people we're having on stage today. Let's go to our very first presenter, Sascha Glasel. Sascha is co-founder of the architecture and spatial development agency Space and Matter. Space and Matter, I think, is doing a lot of great projects. One of them is Schoonschip. You'll find it in Amsterdam North. Maybe you've heard about it. It's all about living on the water. And Sascha is here to tell the story of Schoonschip and much more. So, stage is yours.
Thank you very much. So, yeah, you introduced me already. Thank you very much for the invitation. My name is Sascha Glasel. I'm co-founder of Space and Matter. Space and Matter is an Amsterdam-based agency. We are focusing on concept development, research, and on spatial design, so architecture and urbanism. Today, I would like to talk with you not only about Schoonschip, but about building on water, because we see building on water as a potential answer to the double threat, on the one hand, the climate change, and on the other hand, also the rapid urban population growth, which happens in cities. By 2050, 2 billion people will be vulnerable to flooding. 200 million people will live in areas which are underwater during high tide. And the estimated costs of flood damage will be around $1 trillion annually. If you hear this, I think then you understand that all over the world, there's a lot of people who are already extending on living on water. And these projects and these projects are not necessarily high tech. It's often like also very low tech and very smart and intelligent. What we see as Space and Matter, the biggest challenge is that there are so many cities which are threatened by the water on the one hand, and this extensive growth of cities and extra people who will live in the cities. So how can we deal with that? And how can we come up with solutions living on water? So today I would like to show you that there is like one project I will show you, Schoonschip. We strongly believe that we should live on water and also experiment with water, on living on water, but not just somewhere in the ocean, but connected to the existing cities. There should be a transition between land, from land to water slowly. This initiative, this building initiative, had the dream of building the most circular floating neighborhood in the world. And they hired us, Space and Matter, 10 years ago to help them, because they did not really know how to realize the dream. They had a lot of ideas and a lot of ambition. So we helped them to make a feasibility study, to make a plan, a design, and also think together about a process, how to reach this goal. And of course, this group was like one of a kind. There were a lot of people who had a lot of expertise about sustainability. And together with a lot of experts and a lot of people, we developed this urban plan, which was based on a diversity, like on a social diversity. So we have 7 different housing typologies here. Some of the houses, single families live, and others like 2 or 3 families live. And in order to also reach a architectural diversity, 18 architects were invited to the project to design all these specific floating houses. And that was like enriching the whole process. For the group, it was very important to also represent diversity within the whole project. You can build these buildings in water, or you build them on land. This is an example here you see where some of the houses were built on land. If you do so, you of course have to get them afterwards in the water. And that is not quite an easy action. You need the biggest crane on water in Europe. You can see it. And very carefully lift these boats in the water. And that all looks like very impressive, but if you're there next to it and you build on these houses, then you're really quite excited in the moment where they really touch water for the first time. Building on water is very flexible, so it gives a lot of advantages. It has this function of this instant urbanism, so you can build basically a city within, theoretically, one day. You can assemble all these buildings somewhere and then build this neighborhood literally in one day, as you can see here. That gives a lot of flexibilities in building on water. The building group managed like quite some serious innovation. So they managed to set up a smart grid. So we have 500 solar panels on the roofs of these buildings and 30 batteries in the buildings. All the houses and the energy system is interconnected, and the energy which is produced is exchanged amongst each other. The backbone of the whole project is a smart jetty, which has a very innovative sewage system, where the gray water from all the houses goes in the future to this biorefinery, and we produce biogas and fertilizer from our gray water. And another milestone the group managed to do is also to build all these houses as circular as possible. There's a lot of features like a recirculation shower. There's a heat exchanger in the water, so we make use of the water for heating and cooling the houses, a vacuum toilet, and a lot of natural materials are being used. And the last big pilot the group managed to realize is a mobility hub. So all the households, they share electric cars, electric bikes, in order to have a smaller footprint on the mobility within their surrounding. So what we learned in this project is a lot of lessons, of course, but I think the most important thing here is that a building group managed to build the most innovative floating neighborhood in the world, on the one hand, and of course, that it takes time to innovate. It took 10 years to realize this project. We with Space Matter are now busy with the next steps. We are innovating in material. So we just finished our first hempcrete boat, houseboat, that has outstanding performance, and you need a lot less installation to heat, to cool, and so on. The other thing is we are building blocks, which are a new type of floating foundation, which attracts a lot of biodiversity and other creatures. And then our big mission is now to scale up. We believe we have to build on water like very fast, and in a certain scale. So our idea is to build now 3,000 houses with a lot of program like schooling, education, work, and so on in the near future. And we think we should not do that anymore and build islands, but floating cities. Thank you very much.
Sascha. Next presenter is Joris Hoebe of Reinbeer. Of course, as a result of climate change, it rains heavier in the future, already happening now. One of the big challenges lying ahead of us is how to get rid of all this rainwater. But Joris and his colleagues, they see rainwater as a resource. They are making beer from it. And today he's here to tell you everything about Reinbeer. Yes. Give it up.
Thank you for inviting us at this very important moment in time. I think climate change is happening, and I want to explain something about what we do about climate change and climate adaptation. If the next slide is coming up, you see what the problem is that we are trying to tackle. So you see a lot of rain pipes from houses, and this is basically the whole of the Netherlands is constructed in a way where rainwater goes from your roof directly into the sewers. And we think that's a waste, because we believe at Reinbeer that it's a resource indeed. So in 2016, I founded a company with my companion Wietse Visser called Heaven's Water, and we create creative concepts about climate adaptation, and specifically about the rain that falls from our heavens. In 2016, I worked at the HVA, and you see here the first 1,000 liters of freshly harvested rainwater from the HVA, which we pushed towards the brewery, the Praal, in the city center. And that resulted in a first beer, and later, now 4 years later, we have five beers from five different countries, five different towns in the Netherlands. We have created and sold more than 500,000 beers, and with that we achieved 500,000 conversations on climate adaptation and rain. We had this very cool electric vehicle which drove around the city to pick up rainwater and also bring beer around. And you will see this one later as well, the rain bar, where you could drink beer and have a conversation about beer, and it only rained inside of the bar. We won awards. We had like exposure nationally and also internationally. So it was a big success. However, last year we stopped our business because legislation is stopping us in a way, because what we are doing is illegal, and I will tell you more about that later. This is basically what we are facing. So there's more rain falling from the sky, and we also face these heavy shower peaks, and it has been raining more since 100 years, more 30% more, and we. Even kijken. Yeah, so that information might be not new for you, but what we think is we want to see rain more as liquid gold. So we wanted to see it as a resource. So we are using it for beer, to create beer. And we want to also challenge you to find ways to look around you and map around in the city or in your village what purpose rain could have instead of just throwing it out, of draining it out of the sewers. Because nowadays it's you can't use it for anything. So that's the problem we face, and why we are kind of in the midst of stopping, is that it's illegal to brew beer with and produce stuff with rain. You can't use it to spray football fields, for instance, and you can also the fire brigades aren't also can't use rainwater as well to fight fires. And we think that rainwater is a very safe and sustainable alternative for tap water. And people ask us, is tap water or is rainwater dirty, or is it polluted? We think, well, in our experience, it's not. We use a Dutch innovative technology to filter and check our water. And we as a Dutch, as the Netherlands, are leader in water technology, so we could fix this. But we need a mind shift. So we say, out with the sewer thinkers. We need to harvest the water from the heavens and reuse it, repurpose it. So we started a new campaign to make it more active, and we see a lot of enthusiastic reactions from the people. They want change. We started a campaign called Pijpenkappen, and with the mission to cut 1 million rain pipes by 2030. We see that people want to work in their gardens and reuse the water to water their plants and also fight the drought in that sense. Because we think that the rain pipe is the message. But we need governments and also as new entrepreneurs to find the loopholes in the system, in the legislation, and come up with innovative ideas to fight this. At this moment, we are working on a new beer, so we wanted to stop, but this week we changed our mind because the brewer has found a loophole, and we're expecting to make another beer, a new beer, and we hope to launch that next year in a cafe near you, if COVID-19 allows us to. Thank you for listening. A lot to tell, little time. If you want to have more discussion, or feel free to contact us. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joris. Great story. Seeing rain as a product, I think this is an interesting message that also applies more or less to our next presenter, Laura Selinska of Sense Common. When we were asked to curate this program, this Pecha Kucha program, we wanted to look at climate adaptation in the broadest sense possible. It's raining more often, as also Joris told you. And Sense Common believes when we get wet, we should get wet in style. Laura is here to tell you more about the company. Give it up.
Thank you. So my name is Laura, and I'm the designer and founder of Sense Common, a brand with a unique design approach that is to look for the common between us, our lifestyles, and design clothing products that seamlessly fit into our real lives. Having worked for established brands before, I believe only small and independent, we are able to really be reactive with whatever the world is throwing at us with a sort of doomsday optimism, and still create things that do respect our nature, wildlife, and each other. I am a material nerd, and I believe that the future of clothing lies in material science. And it does not have to be about heartbeat readers or LED light in your clothes. Innovation can be invisible, but there to actually improve your experiences. My goal with Sense Common is to improve how we experience urban life and the often extreme conditions we live in. And to do that, I need to work with the brightest minds and tools of the textile industry and outside it. For that reason, I work with people that I treat as scientists in innovation labs instead of sweatshops, and work with materials that are often actually coming from nature, but enhanced by man and technology. You'd be surprised how much the most adaptive and smart fibers actually come from planet Earth itself, the minerals, the animal world, and the plants, of course. Let's say there is a major major health issue, a pandemic that swamps the world. We are in 2020, and we are certainly far enough in scientific developments for antiviral protection no longer to come in plastic with hardware or impress you with number of layers to be protective. Did you know that a surgical mask is 10 times more unbreakable than any other textile, even synthetic textiles? Solutions such as Viraloft technology I chose to use for since common face masks is invisible to the eye. Applied on a double knit cotton, which eliminates the need of several layers of fabric, this silver salt based chemical treatment basically disinfects the mask, so you don't have to wash it or worry about touching it. The active treatment in our masks not only make navigating this pandemic less stressful, it also takes care of maintaining a natural bacterial flora around your nose and mouth, quite important for people who have to wear masks for 8 hours straight. This is what I call adaptive design, innovation that tackles the actual needs of actual people in modern day society without damaging the environment. So what is another actual need of actual people? We cycle all the time, anytime and in any weather, yet 90% of the solutions for a rainy ride you find are of disposable quality or hideous design. If cycling is such a big part of our lives, why not address it with the same attention you choose everything else in your wardrobe? The mild and seasonal European climate is becoming more and more severe and unpredictable. We need more versatile, multifunctional clothes that actually can adapt in seconds to whatever is happening outside in the street. And what would that be? What are the crucial needs for a rainy ride? On a bike, we are actually in a sitting position with arms to the front. Our legs become as revealed as our shoulders. And breathability is crucial, as it's an activity that makes us sweat. Plus, features like good visibility and reflective elements are there to ensure safety. So how many raincoats that you own cater to any of these needs? Designing solutions and innovating already on the material level makes incorporating beautiful functionality into one smart design possible. Not a quirky experiment, but an actual commercial solution that is durable and sustainable in many ways. Here is the SenseCommon All Commute Overcoat, catering to all the urban commuters' needs, yet light and versatile, it just adds the functionality to whatever else you're already wearing. Instead of thinking in existing categories like gender, seasons, product categories, I design future-proof solutions for all. The SenseCommon All Commute Overcoat protects you from getting soaked down to below the knees, cuts the wind, but remains breathable due to the right material properties and weight choice. Once the weather surprises you again, pack it away in its flat, waterproof pouch and wear it when needed for many years to come, in all seasons. In summer, directly on your skin, and in winter, over any winter coat. It also fits flat in your suitcase. We have to be wise with the tools we use and things we wear, as our air, water, and our future depends on it. On this, I invite you to discover the other smart developments from SenseCommon. Those include low-maintenance products such as Tencel Basics that you only need to wash after every other 5 wears. Another low-maintenance SenseCommon product is On Journey Wear that's made out of activated charcoal fiber, which filters odor and humidity. These natural fibers filter themselves, which for us means saving water, energy, as well as extend the lifetime of our wardrobe. Let innovation into your wardrobes and stay in touch with SenseCommon. Thank you.
Thank you, Laura. Yeah, that's what Pachacucha is. We have to wait for the presentation to end. It's all automatic. Okay, next presenter is Remco Moen of the NK Tegelwippen, or in other words, the National Championships Tile Lifting, a competition that taps into our competitive spirit to make people, stimulate them to turn their backyards and cities into greener spaces. In the coming minutes, you're going to listen to Remco. I think he has a great story about how to empower citizens to play their own role in climate adaptation. Stage is yours.
Thank you, Val. I'm sorry for the English-speaking audience, but I'm going to do this in Dutch because otherwise we're going to lose a lot of humor. Ik ben Remco en ik ben een van de oprichters van Frankly. Frankly is een creatief campagnebureau dat mensen aan het denken zet over maatschappelijke onderwerpen. Dat doen we door het bedenken en produceren van live activaties. Soms omdat we het belangrijk vinden om een verhaal te vertellen en soms worden we ingehuurd om een verhaal te vertellen. We werken altijd voor duurzame organisaties of maatschappelijk betrokken bedrijven. De campagnes die we maken zijn dus activaties. We zetten mensen aan om actie te gaan ondernemen. Meestal doen we dit in een offline omgeving, bijvoorbeeld op grote evenementen of op drukke plekken in de stad. Zo zouden we misschien ook wel hier staan met een activatie, maar dat ging natuurlijk niet door. Een project dat we zelf hebben geïnitieerd is ROEF. Al 5 jaar het hoogste festival van Amsterdam en een beweging die ervoor zorgt dat mensen de stad vanuit een ander perspectief gaan bekijken. Bovenop onze versteende stad liggen 25 vondelparken aan braakliggend terrein. Mensen dat laten zien, dat is het doel van ROEF. En dat doen we altijd op een positieve manier. Dus zonder een opgeheven vingertje. We noemen het de paard van Troje manier. We lokken je op het dak met een festival, met live muziek of met een film. En eenmaal boven aangekomen tonen we je de potentie van dat daklandschap. Want de daken boven ons die bieden kansen. Kansen die een bijdrage kunnen leveren aan de oplossing voor heel veel grootstedelijke problemen. En de opvang van regenwater is daar natuurlijk één van. Rainproof, het programma van Waternet, wat Amsterdam bestand wil maken tegen de steeds vaker voorkomende hoosbuien, is al vanaf jaar 1 partner van ROEF. We bedachten voorheen al verschillende activaties waarmee we onze bezoekers vertellen over de hevige regenbuien. Bijvoorbeeld zwemmen de haaien die je net zag in flatgebouwen of gevangen wolken in een lift. Voor Rainproof bedachten we ook de Rainbar. De enige bar waar het binnen regent, het ging er net al even over. En waar je bier drinkt gemaakt van regenwater, rainbier. Hiermee vertellen we het verhaal van wateroverlast in de stad. Immers, een stad kan niet schuilen. We willen mensen de waarde van het water laten ervaren. Daarom reizen we met deze rainbar van plek naar plek naar plek. We staan ermee op festivals en op andere evenementen, misschien dus wel hier. Maar helaas, nu dus niet. Deze zomer, corona. Een ander project, wat we samen met heel veel andere mensen organiseren, is Dus Wat Gaan Wij Doen? Dus Wat Gaan Wij Doen is een klimaatfestival waarmee we mensen aansporen om zelf de handen uit de mouwen te steken voor een duurzamere toekomst. Hier komen inspirerende sprekers aan het woord, zijn ook Pachacucha's met startende groene ondernemers, maar vooral veel workshops. Wormhotels bouwen, leren fermenteren, je kledingkast uitruimen, zoals gezegd, handen uit de mouwen. Het plan was om dit jaar 2 events te organiseren, 1 in Rotterdam en 1 in Amsterdam. Maar ook daar stak helaas corona een stokje voor, maar we lieten ons niet kisten. Het werden natuurlijk 2 online festivals, te volgen vanaf je eigen computer. Tijdens dit festival werd het startschot gegeven voor het Nederlands kampioenschap tegelwippen. Het verhaal wat we vertelden met de Rainbar hebben we omgezet naar een citizen empowerment campagne. Met het NK spoorden we Amsterdammers en Rotterdammers aan om zoveel mogelijk tegels uit hun eigen stad te verwijderen. Het NK tegelwippen is dus een challenge tussen de inwoners van Amsterdam en van Rotterdam. Waarbij we dankbaar gebruik maken van de aloude titanenstrijd tussen Feyenoord en Ajax. En natuurlijk het uitblijven van alle sportcompetities begin dit voorjaar, want corona. Damsko versus Roffa. We wilden de rivaliteit tussen die steden aanwakkeren, maar dat gebruiken voor iets heel positiefs. Namelijk groenere, meer leefbare steden en ruimte voor wateropvang. Samen de stad meer klimaatadaptief maken. Maar dan zonder die ingewikkelde woorden te gebruiken en vooral door mensen dus zelf de handen uit de mouwen te laten steken. We begonnen eind mei met deze competitie en eind september, na een hele zomer, 4 maanden lang wippen, zijn er maar liefst 94.426 tegels geregistreerd, verwijderd uit beide steden. Dat is ongeveer 1 hectare aan groen erbij. Dat is meer dan de Arena, dat is meer dan de Kuip. En in dit geval is meedoen natuurlijk echt belangrijker dan winnen. Maar je bent misschien toch wel benieuwd wie er dan uiteindelijk met die gouden tegel vandoor ging. De gouden tegel 2020 die ging naar Rotterdam. Maar het was een hele nipte overwinning die tot het eind superspannend bleef. Het scheelde uiteindelijk maar 1500 tegels. Amsterdam kreeg dit jaar de ijzeren schop. Een schopje om het volgend jaar weer net een beetje beter te doen. Het startschot werd gegeven door Laurens Evans. Hij kwam net al even voorbij in het begin. En zijn Rotterdamse evenknie Bert Wijberga. Die zie je ze. Zij namen ook de prijzen in ontvangst aan het einde van de rit. Superleuk om ook van deze mannen te horen dat ze bij elke vergadering of presentatie werden bevraagd over de laatste stand van het tegelwippen. Het leefde. En dat zagen wij zelf natuurlijk ook terug. Elke dag ontvingen we weer een paar nieuwe mailtjes. Want je moest wel met bewijslast komen, dus een bericht met foto's van je gewipte tegels. We zagen schoolpleinen voorbij komen, recordpogingen, geveltuinen. Maar ook mensen die een tegeltje wipten, een single tegeltje voor de deur. Best veel engagement bij ons publiek. En je zag het ook terugkomen op de socials. Er werd over geschreven, de wethouders werden getagd. En dat zorgde uiteindelijk ook voor heel veel publiciteit. Internationaal eigenlijk, zoals je hier ziet, van Korea, maar ook tot de nationale pers. Op nu.nl, bij het startschot werden we op nu.nl genoemd. Er was een interview op 3FM en eigenlijk op allerlei diverse lokale radiostations werden genoemd in het AD. Het werd echt lekker opgepakt. Al die verschillende inzendingen maakten dat we niet alleen de winnende stad een prijs wilden uitreiken, maar ook een wipper. Dat werd de wipper van de maand. 4 maanden lang, uitgekozen door de vakjury, elke maand uit beide steden 1. Deze 8 die deden mee als kanshebber voor de grote publieksprijs. De grote publieksprijs, dat was het gouden schepje. En die, jawel, werd ook gewonnen in Rotterdam. Olivier, a.k.a. de wildsnoeier, die nam tijdens Dus wat gaan wij doen, op zaterdag 10 oktober, de dag van de duurzaamheid, deze prestigieuze award in ontvangst. Maar nu, volgend jaar willen we natuurlijk naast Amsterdam en Rotterdam zien dat er nog veel meer steden tegen elkaar gaan strijden. Want een echt NK, dat is natuurlijk niet alleen maar Rotterdam en Amsterdam. Dus eigenlijk willen we steden uitdagen om ook mee te gaan doen volgend jaar. Om op die manier tot een echt NK tegelwipper te komen. En misschien dan niet 1 hectare, maar wel 20 hectare groen te gaan krijgen. Want immers, als we kijken naar de achtertuinen in Nederland, dan liggen er ongeveer nog 10 Veluwe's aan achtertuinen stenen te zijn. En dat is natuurlijk super zonde.
Thanks so much, Remco. Great story. We are halfway of the program. We have had 4 presenters so far. We have 4 more great people lined up to share their work and projects and ideas with you. Next up is Harro de Jong of Bureau Harro. All the way from Arnhem, I believe, sort of.
It's not so far away. Netherlands is not such a big country.
Not such a big country. Harro is an expert at connecting people with nature, and from dried out riverbeds to rooftop uses, he and his landscape design firm are experts at coming up with innovative nature-based solutions to cope with climate adaptation. Go ahead.
Thank you. Yes, so my name is Harro de Jong. I'm a landscape architect, and today I want to tell you something about and show you some projects that show that climate adaptation makes the world more biodiverse, if you do it right, make it more interesting and makes it more fun. For the first project, we go to the Veluwe, so very close to our office. And as you can see, this was an old camping site. So this is a couple of years ago. And the problem they had over there was water. Well, that was one of the problems. Wild boars were the other problem. We solved that as well. But the water was a big problem. It was coming off these steep hills and gathered in this valley. So the valley and the tents were flooded when it rained heavily. So what we did is what we do often. The problem times 2 is the solution. That's kind of a mathematical law. So what you see in this picture is that we created a valley. So actually we made the valley a valley again. So the waters, when it rains heavily, it gathers in that valley. And this is 1 month later after the previous picture. And you see the nice thing is that the sand collects in that valley, which makes it actually the biggest playground of the area. So what formerly was a problem, the water, is now becoming the attraction and the central point of this whole new recreational site. This is a year later, and then it really looks much nicer. It's much more biodiverse. This camping site has become one with the surroundings, one with the landscape. So those wild boars are actually welcome right now and wandering around there at night. When it is dry, it looks beautiful. And when it rains, it is also a lot of fun. And that's nice on a camping site because there's this creek streaming through the camping site. The same problem on a bit bigger scale is in Arnhem, what we see on this picture. We see an industrial site in the riverbed of Arnhem, left riverbanks. On the right, we see the higher parts of the Veluwe. And we all know when sometimes the river level is too high and that threatens big parts of the Netherlands. So again, what we did was problem times two is solution. We made an extra river. So now you see on this picture two rivers, and we created an island with that. So the sand we dig out for making this new river branch, we throw it aside and we make this island of it. It's that green part. And this is everything that's green is part of the project. So only a small project, part of the project is being actually developed as a residential area. And the rest has become, will become, we're working on it right now, a nature and a recreational area. So once again, this is the place. It's an old, ugly, inaccessible industrial area, but next to the city center of Arnhem. And so you can go to Central Station by foot, but it's in the middle of this riverbed. And what we do is creating this new river branch, making this forested island where people live, where Arnhem will have its beach, where you can swim in that river branch. So much more biodiversity, much more fun, and it is all paid by the houses we build there on that island, so without money from the government. Okay, let's scale up one more time. This is the Frisian coastline. And although the Waddenzee, the Waddenzee, is known in the Netherlands as an important natural area, this is how it looks like from the side. Really boring, industrial, and hard. And yeah, the problem is not solved yet because the sea level is still rising. It already does it since the last ice age, but it goes a bit faster now and the land is going down. So one solution would be, let's heighten up the dike even more. This is a project, a research by design we did a couple of years ago called Friesland aan Zee, Friesland at Sea. And what we came up with is instead of investing the money in a new and higher and broader dike, invest it in a new tidal marshland in front of the dike. In Friesland and Groningen for ages, people have been making new land outside the dikes by making these structures you can see in the pictures that let the sediment actually go down. So the bottom of the sea goes up, and in that way, the height of the water goes down. And in this picture, we see the whole area where we could do that, create these new kwelders, these new tidal marshes that actually protect the land. When we do that, and this is a picture how it could be done. So you see those structures on the, you see those poles, and you see a road going to a destination in the end. So the sediment will stay there. The water will move less than it does right now. The earth, so the soil will go up, as we can see in this picture, and the strength of the waves will reduce because the water level is lower. And therefore, we don't need to heighten up the dikes, but we make these wonderful marshlands that are actually almost not there anymore in the Waddenzee. So this ecosystem has gone. We can make it again. That makes that area even touristically much more interesting than it is right now. And we solve this, we adapt to the climate. But let's go back to the city, the last phase. So we have been different scales, and this is very close to here in Amsterdam. We are working on it right now. I just came from that roof. It's in progress right now. And what we came up with, it is a new apartment building, and we wanted to make a landscape on top of it. And what do we need for those plants to grow and those trees to grow? We need water. So we need to collect the water from the sky, not get it into the sewage system, but contain it on the roofs. This is the system how we do it. It's a so-called polder dock, and it looks very technical. As you can see, this is how it is right now. And next week, the sand will be on top of that. But this layer contains the water, and so the water doesn't go down. It stays up the roof. We put, let's say, a meter of sand. It goes a bit up, it goes a bit down, as you can see in this picture. On top of it, there's a swimming pool in it, so you can swim in a dune landscape on top of your roof. So climate adaptation allows us to make landscapes on top of our cities. That makes the world more biodiverse, it makes it more interesting, and it makes it more fun. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Haro. Great project. Really nice talk. Okay, next one up is Yvonne Modderman. Yvonne founded a vineyard in the middle of Amsterdam in the spring of 2016, together with her partner Jeroen van der Voorn. And today she's here. We invited her to do a Petja Kucha talk about what it is to make wine in the middle of the city, about biodiversity, and about what it is to cope with climate adaptation. Stage is yours.
Thank you. Hello, my name is Yvonne. Thank you very much for the invitation. On the right side of the slide is Jeroen van der Voorn. He's my husband, and we've created this Amsterdam City Vineyard. Actually, we started to talk about changing things drastically by moving over to France or Italy to start a vineyard over there. But then we found out that we love Amsterdam, and we just didn't want to miss the city life. And by that time, we found out about the concept of a city vineyard, which we visited in The Hague. So instead of moving out of Amsterdam and of the Netherlands, we thought we can get green to the city. We can also start this project not doing it everything on our own, but we can create a community, and we can stay in Amsterdam. So that's what we did. We started to talk to the municipality. They gave us very enthusiastic reactions, and we ended up in this very strange area close to the train station Sloterdijk, in the middle of the offices. But when we were there, we started to realize that if we were to start a vineyard in the city, then it would be better to really come up with this strange area and to make it green. So we ended up within the project. It's called the Tuin van Bret. They're all built, they're all connected to the circular economy. All pavilions are made of former sea containers and old building materials. I also created one of the buildings because I'm actually an architect. The community, we found it a lot of people, and we had to start actually from nothing. So with the whole group of 70 people, we started creating this vineyard and doing actually everything ourselves. The idea of the community is that people can join us. So we have 750 vines planted in 2016. And 70 people can join us because we have 70 spots, because you lease 10 vines for 1 year. This is how it looked when we started in 2016. If you join us, we all do the maintenance of the vineyard ourselves and together. So we start pruning in the wintertime, doing the green harvest, and at the end of the season, so that's October, we do the harvesting, which is of course a very intense and nice moment. We celebrate wine because we are all wine lovers, of course. We have a lot of events. Bring your own bottle barbecues. We have the harvest party, and we do tastings. We have dinners, kind of Italian style, under the pergola. And the winemaking we also do ourselves. We pick the grapes ourselves by hand, which brings a good quality. And we create it in the building. We have a kind of a cellar where we can keep the wine. Here you can see the grapes we planted. This is important because they are called peewees, and they are mildew resistant, so they can sustain the wet climate we have here. We got very good reviews on the wine. Esme Langerijs, she's a known wine journalist. She gave this nice comment: "Sodemieter, what a Johanniter! Johanniter is one of our grapes." So we are actually proud of the result, of course, and with us the community. But of course, there were also things going wrong. In the first year, the whole harvest was eaten away by birds. We also got mildew problems. And we also have, last year we had a lot of problems with wasps. And also drought, of course, is an issue in this climate. We were very inspired by The Biggest Little Farm, this nice movie. And what they also do is try to solve all the issues in a bio-friendly way and take a step back in order to find a solution. One of the things is this, the city warmth, which is a positive thing, that we are really close to the city because it keeps us away from the frost, which is coming up in May, and which is for the normal city vineyards, or for the normal vineyards, a problem. But we are kind of safe for that. Since we have our own building, we can use the IBCs to collect water, so we can deal and cope with the drought. Further on, you see here some nets, which is also to protect from the sun. So it's kind of a myth that because of the climate change, it would be easier to create a vineyard. We just need a cool climate with enough sun. But it should not be getting too hot and too dry, actually. We work on biodiversity, of course, with a lot of bulbs, bees, flower species, to just get a more diverse climate in the area, which is, of course, difficult in this Sloterdijk area. We are going to... So I want to repeat that that it's a kind of a myth that... there are a lot of vineyards coming up, but that's due to the PVs, these mildew-resistant varieties we have, and so not so much to the climate. We would like to scale up because we have, if you see the small rectangle, which is our vineyard now, we would like to scale up towards 4 hectares in order to really make a change, because now we are still kind of small. So if you are inspired and would like to give us a hand by realizing this, then mail us, please, to wijnvanbret.nl. And here you see a little impression made by my studio, for how we would like to make a cellar and a wine tasting. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Yvonne, for your great talk. So we've had 6 presenters already. There is 2 more to come. Next presenter is from Eindhoven, designer Lotte de Raad, who works with water in many of her projects. Water is a central element of her projects. And she invites you to connect more to this water and to, for instance, follow its journey all the way from the source to your home. And she has some great ideas to do that. Come listen to her.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is Lotte de Raad, and I'm a designer / ceramist based in Eindhoven. And the first picture you see is in the ceramic workshop. Every year we organizing several workshops in this studio. But it all started like 10 years ago with my graduation project at the Design Academy Eindhoven. I made those tap water carafes. And before I made this design, there was a huge research of where our tap water it was coming from. And in the next slide, you see the 3 different shapes of the carafes. So the tall one is for groundwater, and the left one, depending on... The third one is for dune water, and the first one is for surface water.
So water what is extracted from rivers. And then because I met a lot of people from different water companies, I also met Hans Ruigers of KWR, a water research center, and he asked me, Lotte, can you do something with this leftover material? It's an iron oxide sludge, and they have a huge amount at the production locations, water production locations. So I made an appointment with Brabant Water in Vessem, and I asked them if I could have a look on their production location. They gave me a tour, showed me all the pumps and the terrain and the big lake with the sludge. And at the end, I got one bucket full of iron sludge. So back in the studio, we thought, okay, how can we use this as a useful ingredient on applying on ceramics? So we made this earthenware filter, and it's separating the water from the iron, and what's left in the earthenware filter is like an iron powder. So that was the beginning of the raw material research and make it possible to use it on porcelain, for example. So we made some different glazings and clay bodies. And then together we designed a tableware. So and the tableware collection is existing out of plates, bowls, and cups. And we made a selection of the glazes which were working really well on the ceramic. So at the right picture you see like these some end results. It's high fired, like almost 1300 degrees, and then the iron is melting. But next question was, why should we make another tableware collection? There is already so much on the market. So it would be nice if we can make more like an event for so people people can join and we can share our knowledge. So during the OER workshop, we teach people how to make their own tableware and how they can apply them, the iron oxide on the ceramics. And we tell them the story behind this raw material. So this collection is growing and growing, and the participants are making their own tableware. So I also hope that the value of the tableware is increasing. And this is before the high firing. So after one day, this is the end results. So back to the bucket again, full of sludge. This also brought me to a new assignment together with the Dutch Design Foundation and the Water Embassy. They connected me to Brabant Water again. And we wanted to create more awareness about water issues. So we developed together the drinking water passport. And this is especially made for District Eindhoven. So at the right side, you are seeing the zip codes. And so I'm going to show you some pages from the passport. And this is a famous image. Everybody in Eindhoven knows those water bulbs. It's quite like an icon in Eindhoven. And the map is showing the district. And before the water is coming at the production locations, there are a lot of nature reserves, beautiful places where the different wells are located. And this page is showing consumers of Brabant Water where all their water is going to in their households. So mostly of the water is going to the bathroom. I think also quite interesting to know where you use most of the drinking water. And this is quite interesting images for me as a ceramist. This is about, it's a cross-section of our soil. And as you can see, the clay layer, kleilaag, is protecting our tap water. And the sand layers are filtering the water, so it's a natural filter, our bottom. And we also photographed different wells to give them an image. And this is well 145. and it's 300 meters deep. And the water which is pumped up is more than 10,000 years old. I did not know that, so it's quite interesting to know. And we photographed all the solid materials, so like calcium, magnesium, to give them an image as well, and to show them which are the most ingredients which are not visible in the water. And the next project, hopefully, is to use the iron back on the place where we harvested it in a new pump building of Brabant Water. So we are working on a towel collection at the moment from this raw material.
Thank you, Lotte. Last presenter already of this program, Judith Everaars of Land van Ons. In the end, we believe that climate adaptation goes hand in hand with biodiversity, which is better able to absorb the increasing heat waves we are encountering, or healthy soil life to better store water, heavy rainfall. And Land van Ons is a cooperative which enables anyone to invest in a piece of Dutch agricultural land and help convert it into nature reserves. Judith is here to tell you everything about Land van Ons.
Thank you. In the discussion we have about the climate change, we often talk about the CO2 or the water or the sea level rising or the heat, but we often don't talk about the loss of biodiversity. And this diagram is about the loss of our birds on our farmlands in the Netherlands. So it's really a big problem. And it's not only about the climate change, it's also how we treat our soils and our land. Like, we have big machines, we use pesticides and chemicals, and we have really a big monoculture and big lands. And you see in this picture, you have a soil that's not very healthy and the life is gone. And also the World Economic Forum sees the loss of biodiversity is a big problem, like the point in the arrow. It's a point with a lot of risk we face as humans. And the soil of our ground is the base of and the fundament of our biodiversity. And we talk a lot in the Netherlands, and we are really good in talking and make really good plans. But at the end, if we make decisions, most of the time it's about the money and the profits. So that's quite understandable in a way, because biodiversity is actually an difficult thing. We only see 1% of all life on Earth with our naked eye, and we see a little bit more with the microscope. But we think we only know about 10% of life on Earth, so we don't know nothing about the 90% we don't see. So that's quite a risk, and we play with fire if it goes like this and we have a really bad biodiversity, and with that also problems with our climate. So probably we as humans face the biggest problems. So that's why Land van Ons cooperation started last year. And the cooperation is a cooperation of citizens, and we together want to buy our farmland and to recover the biodiversity and the landscape, and to make a real change in how we farm and to recover our landscapes. And here you see a diagram, and the little orange part in the diagram is the land we own as citizens. And the really big thing, the blue part, is our agriculture land. So that's the place where we want to start and to make the real difference, to bring the biodiversity back. And here you see one of our parcels close to Leiden, and here you see the farmland. It's all grass, it's a monoculture, and it's used a lot of pesticides. And there's no much life left in here. So that's what we want to change. And in the next sheet, you see an article in the newspaper of the Leeuwarden Courant in the north of the Netherlands. And it's talking about the land shift. That's what we want to do. We want a land shift. We as citizens want to buy the land of the farmers. And with that, we want to give our future and our next generation a chance to survive and to help them to bring the biodiversity back and to bring more life on our, in our land and to be more resilient for the climate change we face. So, suppose we pay 200 euros every household in the Netherlands. Then we have, in 10 years, have enough money to buy 15% of our farmland in the Netherlands. And we think with that amount, we can really make a change. And we can make a change to be on a different way of farming, where we can farm with nature. So we don't lean back anymore. We don't sit down on a chair, but we take really action. These are our volunteers on a parcel close to Leiden, and they really take action. They do something about it. And you can do too. With 20 euros, you are a participant of the corporation for 2 years. And we only ask to buy 20 euros of land, of square meters of land, every year. And you can pay more, of course. And you can buy more land. And a lot of people do, because we already have more than 8,000 participants within a year, even less than a year. And we brought together 3.4 million euros. And that's just the beginning. And we really want to scale up. And with this 3.4 million euros, we already bought 4 parcels. Here you see a shot of our land and the 4 places we already bought our parcels. The one is a little bit bigger and the other one is a little bit smaller. But it's the beginning for us. And a cool thing, it's not a gift. You can sell your part of square meters. And we take it really serious. These are students of the University of Leiden taking samples and do research. And we make really well thought plans for the land we buy. So the farmer and we together make a real better plan for the land and to bring the life in the land back. And we do that together with all the participants and the knowledge of them. So we keep the cost low, so it's really a cooperation and all the money goes to the land as much as possible. And then for the future, we tend to buy a real farm. We don't have it yet. And with the farm, we want to give the young farmers an opportunity to farm in another way, with nature together, and to bring life back on the farm. And with that, as a corporation, we give them time and capital. So join us, give yourself a square meter of land, or give it to your friends and family. And as a company, you can give it as a Christmas present to your employees. And it will be your little piece of action to bring back the biodiversity and a way to be resilient to the climate change we face. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Judith. That was a great story. So now you all know what to give for Christmas to your family. I would like to thank our presenters once more. This Petje Kusje program has ended. I hope you're overwhelmed by now by a tornado of creativity that we presented to you. In an hour, the program will continue. We hope to see you back at a Petje Kusje night or Petje Kusje event in the future. Thank you very much for staying with us and watching. Bye-bye.